A lot of people ask me, what is keratoconus? So keratoconus is a distortion of the very front surface of the eye, the cornea, and it's a weakness in the collagen. So the cornea is made up of these collagen links, and these links break. And as they break, the cornea comes out like the end of a rugby ball, so it's pointed like a cone. The majority of these patients have some form of maybe allergies or hay fever, and maybe a little bit of asthma, and they get very itchy eyes. And we're not just talking a little rub, but actually knuckle rubbing or palm grinding. And it's that grinding that helps break the collagen links and allows the cornea to become steeper and also broader. So, you know, it does run in families with brothers, sisters, parents, and then it can be in the family, but if you're not a hay fever allergy sort of a person, you don't get that rub, it doesn't escalate. Keratoconus should not cause blindness. We can fit them up with a contact lens of some description, and we can get them back to fantastic quality of life, driving, holding down a job, going to school, doing what they want to do. If it is not diagnosed, certainly glasses and soft contact lenses will not correct their vision to a reasonable enough level that they can function normally. Blindness, no. If the keratoconus is significant enough that I can't do something for you with the correction and with a contact lens, then there's a surgical options, and then, you know, there's a follow-up further down the track. But yeah, I mean, there's no reason for anyone to go blind from keratoconus. Can you cure keratoconus? The short answer is no. You can certainly improve the vision and the quality of life for patients, whether it's contact lenses. There are various techniques that some surgeons use by putting little corneal inlays and rings in to try and flatten the cornea by pulling the cone back. But the majority of those patients still will need a rigid lens or a soft lens to correct the residual prescription or maybe even glasses. There are some patients who I can't do any more for, and then they'll have a corneal graft where the whole central portion of the distortion is removed and a donor cornea is sewn in. Fantastic results and very amazing techniques now to what they used to do 20 odd years ago when I started practice. So the outcomes are a lot better. There is still a significant proportion of patients who have a graft who will still need a rigid contact lens. Okay, so don't get hopes up that having a corneal graft is going to fix everything. There's also a lot of medication that goes with a corneal graft for potential rejections, and there is the life of the graft. So, you know, you might find yourself at 20 having a graft and you might need to have it regrafted in 20 or 30 years time. So the longer you can hang out and not have a graft, I think is a better prognosis long term. Keratoconus does initially become worse and become steeper and a little bit broader. And the majority of movement of keratoconus is in the teens. So, you know, maybe 11 years old up to, you know, the early 20s, that sort of area. Like I mentioned earlier, there's that genetic component, but if these kids are really hopping in there, that's where the problem arises. We do find that, you know, 20s, 30s, there is very good stability of keratoconus, so it shouldn't change, but it all gets down to this. The more patients rub, all bets are off. It's likely to become steeper and broader. You certainly can have keratoconus without actually realizing it. So, you know, you could be measured and have an astigmatism. The astigmatism can be quite oblique and irregular. But if we can give you good vision with glasses or soft contact lenses, then yeah, you might have keratoconus but function quite normally. It's when the keratoconus becomes quite extreme and quite irregular, whether it's steep or broad in the shape of the cone, that it really affects your vision. That's where you outgrow soft contact lenses and outgrow spectacles. Now, when we talk about an astigmatism, or the way I explain it to a patient is, you know, if the front of your eye is round like a soccer ball, then we can easy enough to correct you whether you're long-sighted or short-sighted. Then the shape of your eye could be like the side of a rugby ball, so it can be long in one meridian and short in the other, and that is an astigmatism. So you could be long-sighted with an astigmatism, you could be short-sighted with an astigmatism. And then there's keratoconus, and that's where, you know, keratoconus is got this irregular manifestation of astigmatism at a very irregular direction, but it, you know, we can correct it only to a certain extent because of how irregular it is. So it's not, if you can imagine the side of a rugby ball, which is, or an egg, long and short. This is the end of a rugby ball, so it's a pointy cone, and it's not working in two meridians. So an astigmatism means that your eye is not round like a soccer ball; it's more football shape. But in keratoconus, if it gets to a significant degree, then it's more of a cone shape, and that's where the two meridians of glasses and soft contact lenses just won't correct and get you that quality of vision that we all desire. So normally keratoconus is misdiagnosed as an astigmatism, and it certainly is a form of an astigmatism, but it's very variable and it tends to change. So patients come in and say, look, I got these glasses 3 or 4 weeks ago, 6 weeks ago, and it's really made no difference. So you get to a stage where you outgrow soft contact lenses and glasses. They just cannot correct. Because with glasses and soft contact lenses, we can only correct in two planes. So one short-sightedness or long-sightedness and the other plane for astigmatism. Whereas with this distortion, what we do with a rigid lens is the tear layer overcomes this distortion, which is between the back of the lens and the front of the eye, and then we've got a new soccer ball front to the eye. So vision's blurred, and you know, traditionally we just can't seem to fix it unless we diagnose it and go, wow, look at that. So for us, we put our patients on a corneal topographer and we're going to map the curve on the front of the eye, and there is a definitive answer, yes you do, or no you don't have keratoconus. Keratoconus can be like a prolapse because instead of being like a, you can imagine a soccer ball, it's now like the end of a rugby ball. You've got this pointy cone coming forward. So yes, certainly. If I get a young keratoconic patient in and they're 11 or 12 and glasses and soft contact lenses are not going to help them, they need a rigid lens, and they're probably progressing, I would send them straight off to a corneal ophthalmologist for collagen cross-linking. And collagen cross-linking is the is trying to strengthen the cornea. So keratoconus is the break in these collagen links and the cone becoming steeper and broader. So it's a very small procedure of using riboflavin, which is like a vitamin B drop, under a UV lamp for 30 minutes or so, trying to strengthen these bonds. And the majority of these cases is fantastic. Stable, there's no further development or change in that cornea, but the same proviso, as long as you don't rub. Okay, so patients can have collagen cross-linking, but if you rub, we're back to where we started. So that's the hard thing. You've got allergies and itchy eyes, but you know, there are also anti-allergy drops that we do use with our patients to calm the eyes down. So there's lots of things that we can do. The most important thing for keratoconus patients is please don't rub your eyes. Types of contact lenses available for keratoconus is, you know, pick a brand or design. So there's you know, we try and keep things as simple as we can for as long as we can. So if we can get a patient with keratoconus across the line with glasses, let's stay there. If they want soft lenses and we can give them good quality of life and vision with a soft lens, we'll go down that path. If we're struggling with vision, our next position is it needs to be a rigid lens of some description. So our you know, I guess the decision's sort of been taken away from us and it's no longer in our hands. All we can do is show the patient, look, this is the best I can get with a soft lens, but you know, or glasses. But you know, if we fit these lenses on you, we can get you down to, you know, what we would call normal vision. And you know, for what I do, my main goal is just, you know, improving someone's quality, doing what they want to do. If you want to go and be a painter or a sign writer or whatever, it's just a matter of giving them that opportunity or the vision to do what they want to do. So there's rigid lenses. We start in our practice philosophy is the little corneal lenses, so it just sits within the coloured part of your eye there. We have the cornea sitting over the coloured part of the pupil, the iris. So we would go small initially. And the reason for that is they're a quicker turnaround, and they're cheaper, and they have a life of 2 years. If for some reason we're just not getting the vision or the comfort, then we'd offer them the next step up, which is probably going to be either a hybrid lens or a scleral lens. They cost a lot more, their life is a bit different. The hybrid is probably around 12 months, whereas the scleral is still going to be 2 years, but the cost is a lot more, and they take a little bit longer, maybe 10 days to 2 weeks for them to arrive. When I sit down with a patient, is put all the cards on the table and say, look, this is where you are, this is what your topography, this is what the shape of your eye looks like, and I can only do this. Anything less than that is a poor visual outcome. So there's lots of variables. It really depends on the patient and where they've been, we do certainly have patients where we start with one type of lens and that's not for them, and we'll, you know, morph onto a different one. We just do things very differently to what a traditional optometrist would do, and that's what we do. It's a lot of chair time what we do. These patients need to come back. They pick up a pair of lenses. We need to see them in a week to 10 days and find out what's the good, the bad, and the ugly. What's, you know, irritating, gritty, or do we need to do something about the vision? So it's a lot of chair time, but a lot of our patients are in that situation where, I guess you could say, they're desperate. They need someone to give them that next step. Otherwise, I won't drive. I won't have a job. And so it's very fulfilling because I guess I don't stand back often enough when, you know, patients come in and say, you're not allowed to retire because without you, I can't do A, B, and C. So, yeah, you know, we're a bit strange because of what we do is a bit odd, but it's a fantastic challenge and you can make a great difference. So I think the best way, there's two options, but the best way to make an appointment to come in here is probably the best is to ring and chat to Maureen on the phone or Dee about what you think you have or where you've been and try and get a feel for what you need. You can certainly go online and fill out an online form and email it in, and then we can get, you know, in contact with you and sort out an appointment time. Try and work out, you know, what are your needs and, you know, who do you need to see. So Lee, all these links that we're talking about will be in the description below. So if you like this video, please subscribe and please share it with your friends.